Hey everyone, we are here on the Disrupt TV stage at Disrupt SF 2015 in the middle of Startup Alley, and we are joined by someone that I'm a big fan of, the CEO of Udemy, Dennis. So how are you doing, my friends?
Good.
Are you enjoying the event so far?
Yeah, it's great. It's fantastic. The energy is amazing.
Is it too hot though? I feel like we're a little warm. All right. For people who don't know, can you give us almost the elevator pitch for your company? Just the shortest possible explanation of what it is and why you do it.
Yeah, absolutely. So Udemy's mission is to help anyone learn anything, and we do this by providing this marketplace where any expert can teach an online course. So today we've got over 8 million students learning from over 30,000 courses taught in 80 different languages. So it's really a global community of teaching and learning.
So I can go there and pick a topic on, say, blacksmithing or, you know, build an airplane, or how diverse is the set of material that you have that I can access?
Yeah, so let me back up by saying about 70% of what we do is what I call professional skills development.
Sure.
And then the other 30% is more personal enrichment or casual interests. So on the professional side, these can be things from anywhere from technology to business. It can be soft skills, it can be hard skills. So it's a combination, whether it's negotiations to mobile application development. But it is very much focused on practical skills as opposed to putting traditional academia online. And as I mentioned, it is very much global. We've got students and instructors all around the world.
So there's a lot of people here that are building stuff to make a lot of money. They're capitalists, if you will.
Sure.
But in your space, education, it feels there's more to the business than just business. Because you're helping people learn, there's almost a different set of rules. So do you guys invest specifically in helping people that are underprivileged or in third world countries have better access to information, or do you focus more on developed markets and so forth?
Yeah, so as a platform in an open marketplace, we absolutely do focus on equality of and access for education everywhere. So if you think about it, within the US, when people perceive the problems of education, most of the times we talk about affordability. But outside the US, that's not the core focus of what people are trying to solve. It's much more around accessibility.
So they distribution, actually, not dollars.
Absolutely. Okay. So what they don't have is they actually don't have instructors or content. They don't have a school to go to. What we do is we basically bridge time and space by bringing instructors and content to them. So whether it's in a local language at an affordable price, those are definitely things that we focus on.
But isn't that all predicated on these people actually having internet access? What if you don't have a connection? I mean, is there a way to use your product via like flash drive or like smoke signal carrier pigeon? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, absolutely. So we do have a lot of different mobile applications, and on either Android or iOS, usually a little bit more Android, obviously, than different emerging markets, you can download the material. Otherwise, everything is on demand.
So I could go to a place with Wi-Fi, say a local government building, download my stuff, and then take it home with me and access it even if I don't have a connection at my house.
You got it.
Okay. Now, it's 2015, and it's a really strange year for money.
Yeah.
There's been some of it bouncing around, you could say.
Sure.
And it's become the new thing to talk about. So we're here, let's do it. You guys just secured a $65 million Series D May.
You got it.
And that brings you up to, what, $113 million total?
Yep.
All right, so that's a lot of money, and you raised more than half of it, or around half of it, in one chunk. So I'm very curious why your capital needs are so large, and where you plan to actually deploy that money.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So, look, the business is working, and what we're seeing right now is that the growth outside the U.S. is far outstripping pretty much everywhere else. I mean, we're still growing very well within the U.S., but what we're seeing now organically is growth everywhere outside the U.S.
So what we're trying
to do is build out our international operations and product capabilities to be able to support that more than anything else.
Will this lead to more localizations based on language and culture?
Absolutely.
Okay, so that's probably not cheap to do on a per country basis.
You got it, you got it. If you think about it, let's step back. If you are a student in one particular country, sometimes the things that you're going to want to learn will be slightly different than what we learn here or what we want to learn here in the U.S.
Based on your day-to-day life, your cultural needs, and all that stuff.
Yeah, so that's one piece. The other piece of it is students are going to learn better from an instructor that's speaking the same language, has the same culture cues. So there does need to be that localization aspect, and that's why we think this marketplace approach is valuable.
Does the cost of building out that sort of network make you worried from a CapEx or an OpEx perspective? It's not cheap to do this.
Yeah, no doubt. So the most important thing is we've got this long, long view of where this is going, right?
Okay.
We've got a huge mission, we've got a long way to go. And if you think about it from a business standpoint, what are the three things that you need to worry about? You've got market risk, you've got execution risk, you've got capital risk. We want to take that off the table. We want to control our own destiny and make this go as long as possible.
Before we let you go, you recently announced that your revenue is up 200% on a 12-month basis. So when I think about your growth on a financial sense, is this more recurring revenue or more one-off individual transactions?
Sure, so the way it works for our students is everything is a la carte on an individual basis. So it's not an ongoing subscription model, but what we do track is clearly from a cohort standpoint, when we look at students that sign up with us 1 year and they come back year over year over year, they basically behave like a subscription business. So they basically, what
so
we find
is- So it's not directly that, but it works out to a roughly similar set of flows.
We're providing enough value for them to come back year over year.
So you can track your revenue pretty carefully then. Okay,
got it.
So last question because we're out of time. Are we in a bubble?
I'm going to leave that one to the experts. what I can say is we've got students and instructors around the world that are really benefiting from what it is that we want to do, what it is that we are doing, and we've got a long way to go. So we're excited for the road ahead.
All right. Dennis, thank you very much.
All right, thank you.